If you are using Airtable to its fullest, there's a really good chance that you are using a script or two here and there. In this video, I'm going to be showing you the three most needed scripts. I'm talking about going to my team and saying, hey folks, what are those scripts that you could not live without? These are the results, top three in this video. If that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner here at Gap Consulting, and it's our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools. One of our favorite no-code tools, as you might have guessed, is Airtable, and we use it to build so many solutions for our clients and students. If you are interested in no-code, if you're just kind of figuring this out for the first time, I first want to invite you to join me for my Airtable crash course. This crash course is packed full of all of those key features in Airtable so that you can unlock the full potential of the software. Go ahead and grab that crash course, 100% free, at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. It's going to get you up to speed quickly inside of Airtable. But without further ado, let's go ahead and start breaking down the three different scripts that you really, really need to know if you are going to unlock the next level inside of Airtable. Now, before we get going, though, I do want to tell you, I'm not a scripter. I haven't written any of these myself. These are those scripts that we kind of keep in a library. We copy and paste them anytime we might need this kind of functionality. This is stuff that we wish that we could do in Airtable natively, but unfortunately, it's not yet a part of the native software, but we can do it with a little scripting help. All right, the first one I want to take a look at is grabbing a timestamp. So why would you need this? Before I share the script, why would you need this? Well, imagine that you're running an automation and you want to capture the time that somebody marks this as to do. And you want to take that and just mark that time right into date time. Yes, we have a last modified time field, right? There's a field type called last modified, and you can grab that, but it is metadata. You can't update it. You can't adjust it. You also can't necessarily use it in any meaningful way inside of other automations. Now, the hack for this is to create a formula here that brings back the now time. Now, you might have done this yourself. You might have a now function running inside of your databases. And just by bringing this in, this now function is gonna figure out, like, what is the current time, like, as of right now? I'm recording this video on November 21st, right around, well, not 11:03, as you see here, but I need to bring it back into mountain time. I'm at 4:03 p.m. my time. And so you could use this. Now, the issue with grabbing this function, though, and then using it in a further step of your automation, is that this will slow down your database a lot. The now function is very, very resource heavy. So is the today function, by the way. If you are newer to Airtable, you might not know. If you use the today function, it's very resource heavy, just like the now function. And the reason is, it's having to recalculate that function over and over and over again in the background for every record that's in your database. That's a lot of resource bandwidth. Don't do that to your database. Don't flood it with now functions. In fact, I kind of wish they would just take the now function out of Airtable because it's so resource heavy. So here's the workaround, folks. Let's say you wanted to do this where you say, I update the status. I want to figure out what's the actual time right now, and then I want to plug it in right here. Well, let's do that. Let's start by building an automation. We're going to say when record matches conditions is the trigger, and we're going to set up our three scripts table. The condition is that the status is to do. When that happens, let's choose a record. Right there, we're gonna run a script. We want to basically call upon this moment in time, but we don't wanna do it all the time in the background of our database like the now function would. We just wanna do it when we need it in the automation. So let's run a script. All we have to do is paste that function in just as you see it right here. I'll go ahead and include this in the description of this video so you can grab this copy. Paste that in and then run a test for this automation. And when you do this, you're going to get the output of the exact moment in time as a timestamp that this thing ran. How is this useful? We can use this value, this output, in the next step. So let's say we're done editing here. We finish it up And now as a final step, we're going to go back and we're going to update the record that performed this automation. So back in the three scripts table, what record are we updating? Well, it's the record that started the whole thing, the record ID from the trigger. And what are we going to update? We're going to drop in that date time, and we want it to be a dynamic output now, or dynamic input, I should say, the input coming from the script. So the script's output is the date time stamp of now, whenever this automation runs. So grab it and plug it in, and then we're going to generate a preview. And what we're going to see is it's going to fill out that date time stamp for us right here at 4:08 p.m. Mountain Time. That sounds pretty close. So let's go ahead and rename this automation, say timestamp. And this, my friend, is the first of our three key automations. Let's take it out for a spin here with our fancy little script. When I update the status, what's going to happen? It's currently 4:10 according to my clock. I hit to do. That status triggers the automation. That should be running the script in the background and soon plugging the automation date time right here. Let's see. There it goes. Plugged in at 4:10 p.m. Now, if we take a look at the automation run itself, we can go ahead, look at the run history. It ran successfully. And when this performed, it output the date time when it was operating. So if you ever need to know when an automation is being performed, use this script. So, so easy. One simple little line of code, as you saw right here. I wish I could credit the person who originally came up with it. I did not write it myself, but go ahead and grab this and improve your automations. Now, let's move on to script number two. Sometimes you might have an automation and you need it to wait. You need it to take some time before it does the next thing. You might need to wait for something to be updated, or maybe you need to wait for someone to have a chance to respond to something. Whatever the case may be, you need to put a delay in your automation, and you can't do it natively in Airtable without a script. Well, here it is. Let's go ahead and add this script in. We're going to add on to our original automation. So with our timestamp, we took a timestamp of when the thing originally ran. Let's say we want to wait 5 seconds, 10 seconds, whatever. Well, we can add another script here. So I'm going to click down and run a script again. And this time I'm pasting in a different script. This one's a little bit longer, but basically the same thing. This is going to give me a 5 second delay. Now, again, I have not written this script, but if you see the amount of time that it's cycling through right here, it's 1 to the 7th. And so in terms of milliseconds, so that is going to get us the 5 seconds that we're looking at. This is the part right here that you would want to increase if you needed a longer delay. So if you needed to sleep even longer, go through this loop even more, that's absolutely fine. You can just change the amount of time that you want to allow it to do this. Okay, let's give this a test. Just sit back and wait. This should take 5 seconds. There we go. That's all it did. We see actually the test runtime was 3.3 seconds, but close enough. If you need a brief delay in an automation, which is something that we use a lot of, this is the one. So in order to prove to ourselves that this is actually working and delaying as we had hoped, let's now add yet another step. We will replicate the original script that I did right here. Let's go ahead and grab it. I'm going to go back in here, grab this. After our delay, we're going to run our timestamp script a second time. And then, finally, I'm going to take the output from this and update, again, the same record, but now I'm going to update it in a different timestamp field. And let's go ahead and grab that right here. This is the record I want to update. And in my date timestamp number 2, and we'll bring in our most recent element into the date time number 2. So let's think really quickly about what our automation is doing, because we just made a pretty big improvement or adjustment to it. When we mark a status as to do, we're going to run a script to find out the exact moment in time. And then we're going to update the date time 1 with that moment in time. Then we're going to perform another script that waits approximately 5 seconds. Then we're going to grab the date time again, and then we're going to update the next date field with that date time. Now, the thing I want to point out to you, let's first update this and head on back to our data. We're not going to really see the 5 second delay because we're only tracking minutes here. But we should be able to calculate and see exactly how many seconds have gone between these two things. So let's go for time difference, and I'll use a formula here, and I'll simply say if both of these things exist. So I'll say and if there is a date time and a date time two, under that condition, then I want to perform a little bit of date time difference. So I'll say, let's calculate the difference between those two different date times. That is date time and date time two, and give it to me in seconds. Okay, so kind of fast here on the formula writing, but this formula is just saying, if I have two different date times in the same record, calculate their difference. I want to see how many seconds have transpired between those two things. Before saving, I have to be sure to close out with an extra parenthesis here. We can create that field, and we can also go in and add some different number formats here. So if I want to see like a certain number of decimals, for example, I can do that. Let's go to the three decimal places. And let's give this a shot. Let's see if our new automation is up to the task. I hit to do. That's going to then take the first timestamp, plug it in, wait 5 seconds, take the next timestamp, plug it into date time two. Should see that any second now. Come on. All right. So our delay, not exact science, but it did delay. It delayed for 8 seconds in our example. So there you are. We could run this a number of times and test it and see if maybe some differences need to be made to the actual amount of time that we're delaying. Again, I didn't write the script, just borrowing it. But if you need something that's giving you just a slight delay in your automation, this script is for you. Now that takes us to our third and possibly most valuable script that we use over and over again, and that is having to do with sending a record ID to a webhook. This is very useful if you're working with any external tools outside of Airtable that have webhooks enabled. So for example, one of the most popular times is if you're using make.com and you need to trigger an automation from a webhook. Another popular time is if you're using a different software that also relies on some sort of webhook signal being sent. One that I use, for example, for my website is Kajabi. It does not integrate nicely with a lot of tools, but it does have webhooks. You might use Stripe or some other similar tools to that. Webhooks are all over the place, all over the internet, and sometimes we need to send messages to the different software. So, as I said, the most popular use case is when we're using make.com. And so for that, you've probably seen this one before on our channel, we have a webhook for sending information to make and triggering an automation. So when we set this up, we say, hey, whatever those conditions are, let's say, for example, we're doing this under the condition that the status is in progress. When that happens, then we're going to use this script. And let's go ahead and create a script here and just paste this one in. What we first need is the webhook endpoint. So where are we sending this information? And then usually what we want is to also then tell it some more information about what we're trying to get accomplished. So if we're working inside of Make, one of the most popular use cases is to send the record ID. So in this case, what we would do is say, under the condition that our status is whatever that status I just picked is, then we're going to send information to this webhook, and we have to add an input variable that we call record ID. Make sure you get this with the proper case sensitivity here, because that will matter. So I just drop in record ID, and we have to bring a value in. And you see here, we have the ability to access everything from the record. And what I want is that record ID. So this basically is going to send to your webhook, and it's going to send the record ID of the record that you chose. And so you need to also update the part that says your webhook to whatever your endpoint is. But this particular script, we use it all the time for building automation with Make and for sending information to different third-party software, as I mentioned. So all we have to do then is hit test once we're done here. Of course, I don't have anything meeting that condition, so let me back out, go back to my data, and I'll set something up with the in-progress status. Flip back into my automation now, and let's give it a test. Here it goes. It found this, and it's going to have an output here. And we have to actually click in to this particular step in order to see this. Now, my webhook, you know, your webhook is not a real address, so it failed to actually send this. But if you had your own webhook here, it would then append it with the record ID right after that. And you can see right here that it's trying to send the record ID over to a webhook. Again, this webhook does not exist, but this is the script you need. In any case, these three scripts are going to revolutionize the way that you build in Airtable. I know we went fast here, but be sure to grab those scripts down below in the comments. And in the meantime, keep on building.